Good morning.
A couple of words of introduction. Welcome again. It's really a pleasure to have all of you here today for a one-day symposium devoted to the question of Christian family life and the challenge of faithfulness. I want to begin with an anecdote. A couple of years ago, a Benedictine friend of mine wrote and asked about the Orthodox tradition of having a rite of second marriage. He sent his request for conversation during the meeting of the extraordinary Vatican Synod on the Family. During the course of what became an ongoing online discussion, and you know how those go, tensions began to flare as more people joined the discussion. Some people viewed the Roman Catholic interest in the Orthodox permission for a second marriage to be a sneaky way of tolerating divorce as inevitable and thus degrading the sanctity of marriage. Some Orthodox who joined the discussion pointed out that the rite of second marriage is a concession to weakness and has always been undesirable among the fathers of the church, a way of illuminating the ideal of marital fidelity in monogamy, since it is an exception and not the rule. As these discussions continued, I didn't think about the individuals who were engaging in the online debate so much as I did about the students who were coming to my classes. These students, I was meeting them at various stages of their lives. Many of them were between the ages of 18 and 22, but some of them were much older. And some of the students were experiencing the sting of shame. This is actually a rather common refrain in the classroom. The sting of shame when one of their relatives is unable to receive Eucharistic communion for years because of a civil divorce. In addition to this shame, I also met many other students, and I still do to this day, who have questions about what it means to have a family, what it means to belong to a community, and what it means to belong in general. Questions which are not easily addressed because when they're in the classroom, their cell phones are constantly blurting instant messages to them, and they seem to be tempted over and over again to return to that person who is asking for their attention on Facebook or Instagram to respond to the most recent photo. And it's this need to respond, this impulse to be on hand, to be available 24/7, which raises the larger question of what it means to belong to the microcell of the family and to the larger community, the community of church, the community of a university, the community of our neighborhoods. So this leads to a rhetorical question: what is family? And perhaps more importantly, how does one remain faithful to family when work and play are available to us 24/7? What is family when our cultural marketplace finds a seemingly inexhaustible supply of products and materials promising to fulfill our natural impulse to belong to a community? Finally, can diverse Christian traditions find common ground in defining family and celebrating faithfulness in an age of the acceptance of plurality and relativism? I am very glad to welcome you today to the 2016 Huffington Ecumenical Symposium. Today we will begin to consider the fundamental questions of family and faithfulness in an environment of dialogue and an exchange. It is our honor and pleasure to welcome our panelists, many of whom have traveled from far lands just to be with us. I would like to single out two of our panelists and one special guest. First, I would like to welcome my own diocesan bishop, Archbishop Benjamin of the Diocese of the West Orthodox Church in America. It's an honor to have you here, Your Eminence. Thank you for being with us. He will be responding to the afternoon panel. It's also an honor to welcome Father Russ McDougall, who's in here somewhere. There we go, from the Tantur Ecumenical Institute in Jerusalem. Father Russ and I have been discussing ways that our two institutes might collaborate, and so we're really grateful to have you with us, especially as you adjust to the time change. And we're also very happy to have with us Bishop Guy Irwin of Southwest California, of the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America. Please join me in welcoming our guests, thanking them for being with us today. For those of you who have been to our events before, you know that we have traditional lectures, responses, and followed by question and answer sessions. And for those of you who will be facilitating, please remember that we want questions and not long statements when people come to the microphone. We are also very pleased to offer everyone lunch today at noon, and we will close the event with a festive reception at 3:30. We will start in about 7 minutes, so if anyone wants to step out and grab a last cup of water or a coffee or use the restrooms, which are right behind us, we can use this time as an interim period to adjust as our panelists get settled and meet our panel chair, my colleague, Dr. Brett Hoover.
Symposium that was just saying, it was in a huge hall, really gorgeous, but you couldn't hear, you couldn't understand the words.
I may have done this once or twice before. So you all can stand? Wonderful.
Yeah.
I will. I may move to there when you're speaking, just so you can see me if I have to give you a time cue. It's just like church, right?
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
And so that makes it really different. So
yeah,
who's
I would
going
imagine.
To be in the front?
Yeah. Does it mean people more in the front?
Well,
or?
A lot of times families go in the front because it means the children can see what's happening.
Not,
but it also means they're in the front where everyone can see their
right.
misdeeds too.
Right.
So.
Disruptive.
Yeah.
It sounds like maybe we should begin. Good morning, everyone. I'm delighted to be presiding over this morning session on Christian perspectives on contemporary family life. So are we all ready? Are we feeling energetic and ready to listen? All right, yeah. You can tell I teach undergraduates. My name is Brett Hoover. I'm an assistant professor of pastoral theology here at Loyola Marymount University. So I'm very pleased to be here with you discussing this topic of contemporary perspective or the contemporary family life and Christian perspectives, considering so much of what I do is trying to kind of mine the Christian tradition to understand our contemporary world and ministry and life in it. So I have the wonderful job of introducing our panelists, which I will now do presently. And we are delighted to have with us beginning with Dr. Carrie Frederick Frost, who is a scholar of Orthodox theology, a PhD from the University of Virginia, and she did her dissertation on motherhood. And she's written several papers dealing with family life, and she is soon to be teaching at St. Sophia Seminary. So we're very glad to have Carrie with us today. I would also like to introduce Dr. Julie Hanlon Rubio, who's a professor of Christian ethics at St. Louis University, one of our sister Jesuit institutions. And her area of specialization is also family life. She's the author of books on marriage and family life, as well as a new book coming out soon, Catholic Hope for Common Ground, which certainly is something that I'm hoping for. So we're very happy to have Julie with us as well. We also have Sarah Hinckley Wilson, a Lutheran pastor and adjunct professor at the Institute for Ecumenical Research in Strasbourg, France. Wow. So she may win at least a preliminary award for being here from far away. She's the author of academic and popular works and the founder of the Luther Reading Challenge on the internet, which sounds like a wonderful project to me. So we're very happy to have the three of them with us today. We're going to be hearing them speak, and I will give them a little nudge if time becomes a problem, but I don't think it will. Then we'll hear from two respondents, which I will introduce when they're finished, and then there'll be time for conversation, which, as Deacon Nick reminded us, is oriented to questions rather than comments. So I thank you for your attention, and I would like to introduce Dr. Carrie Frederick Frost.
Good morning.
Good morning.
How is that sound? Can you hear me with the microphone there? Thank you. Louder? Okay. Let's see if I can make it closer. How's that? Okay. Still can't hear me? Okay.
Come closer.
You could move down to the front. That is an option. There's seats down here. Okay, we'll see how that goes. Is that better right there? Okay, great. So good morning, venerable hierarchs, reverend fathers and sisters and brothers in Christ. It is wonderful to be here. It is an honor to be here. As a graduate student, I had the good fortune of coming into contact with faithful Christians of Catholic, Lutheran, and other Protestant persuasions. And up until then, I'm a little bit embarrassed to admit this, I had lived a pretty cloistered life as an Orthodox Christian. I knew other Orthodox, and I had plenty of friends and coworkers who were not practitioners of any faith, but I really had had very little experience with other Christians. And my time with them was a boon. Not only did I learn about their traditions and better reflect on my own, I also came to appreciate the sense of unity that is palpable when Christians gather together in good faith. I appreciate that today here at the Huffington Ecumenical Institute, and it is in that spirit that I offer this talk on an Orthodox understanding of marriage. So imagine with me, if you will, a gold Byzantine marriage ring. So this is like a signet ring from the 5th century. On it, it shows a united couple. Their names are Aristophanes and Vigilantia, as we know, because the names are embossed on the ring. And they're standing in profile in front of a cross. They're locked and gazed with each other. Their noses are nearly touching. There are many other rings like this. Another such ring features two full-length images of spouses who are unnamed, and their hands are being joined together by Christ himself who stands between them. These rings commemorate early Christian marriages. The figures may vary. Sometimes it's just the couple, or maybe they're accompanied by Christ or a bishop or a priest or their sponsors. And their inscriptions can vary too. Sometimes there's a wish for the marriage, such as from God, concord, grace, and health, or maybe just a one-word acclamation like harmony. These marriage rings are a small but powerful example of the enduring Christian esteem for marriage, even in the context of the early church that often ranked marriage second to consecrated virginity. By their presence and the material culture of early Christians, this jewelry indicates that a Christian understanding of marriage was already deeply woven into the fabric of the church. And we see this enduring interest in marriage indicated today by the recent Catholic Synod on the Family, and also the anticipated Great and Holy Orthodox Council's discussion of marriage due to take place in June of this year. Furthermore, in their uniqueness of these rings, no two are identical, but all are variations on the same theme, these rings illustrate the pastoral economia that is employed in particular situations of marriage in the Orthodox context. Today, I will delve into this Orthodox context by looking at what I see to be the central qualities of different Orthodox theologies of marriage and what I understand to be their central deficiency. I am using the plural here, Orthodox theologies of marriage, because in my mind, there is not one Orthodox theology of marriage, and I wish to acknowledge that. However, I see there to be three common interrelated themes to different Orthodox theologies of marriage, and I will elucidate these. So first, the understanding of marriage as a sacrament, then the significance of the Eucharist to marriage, and finally, the eternal potential for marriage. Within Orthodoxy, we don't quite have a discrete, agreed-upon list of sacraments, or as they are more commonly called in the Orthodox setting, mysteries. Instead, there's a very expansive understanding of the sacramental. Much of life can be understood as sacramental, and that, when it is rightly ordered, it brings the divine and human together. However, Orthodox Christians do see particular liturgical rites as sacraments, because they involve specific human persons in these epiphanic moments of divine human communion. Sacraments, however, are not sureties. They are not guarantees. Even with this moment of divine human connection, there's no guarantee that that will be sustained within a marriage. Through the grace of God and the efforts of the spouses and the community around them, perhaps it will be. And as with the sacrament of baptism, where there's no certainty that the newly illumined will live a life growing in Christ, there's also no certainty that a particular marriage will grow in Christ. Within Orthodoxy, there are even some who contest marriage as a sacrament, arguing that there's not a strong enough calling down of the Holy Spirit in the service itself to proclaim it so, and thus they suggest that marriage is better understood as a blessing. This is a minority view, I would say, and I am willing to set aside this objection because I see that the majority of Orthodox agree with contemporary Archdeacon John Krzyzowski's when he writes, quote, "Marriage is, according to the Orthodox view, a sacrament because through it, God directly reveals the heavenly kingdom to the world and to specific persons. Furthermore, during the middle of the second millennium, when the use of the Ephesians passage on marriage, 5:20-33, settled as the universal epistle reading in the rite, this passage, along with the gospel reading of the wedding at Cana, signify a sacramental understanding of marriage. Indeed, for most Orthodox, St. Paul's comparison of marriage and the relationship of Christ and the church, and his proclamation of marriage as a great mystery, are sufficient testimony to marriage being understood as a sacrament in the Orthodox context. The embrace of marriage as a sacrament began early in the Eastern Church, though it took centuries for the sacramental rite itself to develop. While all the details are not entirely clear, it seems that the practice of civil marriage was accepted by Christians East and West. So in the early church, the church did not legally marry anyone, but the church found ways to baptize marriage into Christianity, including ritual action in the context of the liturgy. This occurred in the joint reception of the Eucharist by the married couple, as I will discuss in a moment, but also in the burgeoning tradition in which the couple was publicly blessed during the liturgy by a priest or a bishop. An indicator of this tradition is found in Ignatius of Antioch's letter to Polycarp from the early second century, in which he instructs, quote, "It is right for men and women who marry to make their union with the consent of the bishop, that their marriage may be for the Lord and not for passion. Let all things be done for the honor of God." Here, marriage for the Lord points to the growing understanding in the early church of marriage as a sacrament. The understanding of marriage as a sacrament relates to the importance of the sacrament of the Eucharist within Orthodox marriage. Before there was an established Christian rite of marriage in the early church, a Christian couple, as I have just noted, first married in a civil ceremony and then came to the church and received the Eucharist together. This, in part, brought their marriage into the church and made it Christian. Tertullian attests to this when he writes in the 4th century to his wife that marriage is, quote, "arranged by the church, confirmed by the oblation," meaning the Eucharist, "sealed by the blessing, and inscribed in heaven by the angels." In the early church, the sacraments of baptism and ordination were also celebrated in the context of the Eucharist. It seems that the church further sanctified these rites of passage by their proximity to the Eucharist. Furthermore, the relationship between marriage and the Eucharist is predicated on the Orthodox understanding of the medicinal properties of the Eucharist. Before the reception of the Eucharist in any given liturgy, Orthodox pray, "May the communion of your holy mysteries be neither to my judgment nor to my condemnation, O Lord, but to the healing of my soul and body." This prayer encapsulates a central Orthodox understanding of the Eucharist, that it heals. As a communal partaking of the body and blood of Jesus Christ, the Eucharist works to repair all that ails a person or a community through its mediation between the human and the divine. There's a strong sense in Orthodoxy that all sacraments are completed and fulfilled in the Eucharist because of this mediation and because of the healing that is its result. In the late first millennium, as the marriage rite itself kind of coalesced in the Eastern Church, the Eucharist sometimes came in the form of the pre-sanctified gifts, meaning that the Eucharist was consecrated prior to the service. Yet, in the 10th century, things changed. Any celebration of the Eucharist was mostly removed from the marriage rite. And this is because of the imperial decree of Byzantine Emperor Leo VI, who brought legal marriage into the church's domain. Christians no longer had their marriage first sanctioned by the state and then Christianized by the church. Now both actions were underneath church purview. As the distinction between the secular and the sacred dissolved, rites were altered and things got a little complicated in terms of the church's new oversight of marriage, but also divorce and remarriage. Prior to the decree by Leo, Christians could legally divorce and remarry under the state, but they would have needed to have communicated with their priest about when, perhaps after penance, they would again receive the Eucharist and thus have that marriage made a Christian one. After Leo's decree, the Eucharist was removed from the rite as an acknowledgement that the church might now be marrying couples who were, due to divorce or otherwise, not ready to receive the Eucharist during the rite. Over time, the common cup, which is a sharing of a cup of wine at the conclusion of the rite, came to be understood as a Eucharistic substitute. However, this was not its original symbolism, given the textual evidence of the common cup's dates to well before the the time that the Eucharist was separated from the rite. Even today, when the reception of the Eucharist during the established rite is rarely practiced, although sometimes practiced, and the norm is that the Orthodox couple will receive the Eucharist together throughout their marriage, thus healing their rifts and sealing their marital communion between divine and human again and again. The third quality of marriage in Orthodox theological thought that I wish to elucidate is the notion of marriage as potentially eternal. Although marriage predates Orthodox Christianity and Orthodox Christianity continues to have no monopoly on marriage, Orthodox Christianity understands marriage as imbued with the possibility of the mutual transfiguration of its partners into the kingdom. Not only do the spouses work towards each other's deification, their union may be preserved in the life to come. There's no mention of parting at death in the Orthodox marriage rite. In fact, most Orthodox premarital material emphasizes that the couple should plan to be in it for the eschatological long haul. Evoking a baptismal understanding of things, an encyclical letter of the Orthodox Church in America puts it this way, quote, "For those who fight the good fight as good and faithful servants, the crowns, meaning the ritual crowns that are placed on the heads of the bride and the groom during the rite, the crowns become their eternal reward as witnesses to Christ, and the wedding garments are transformed into robes of salvation and glory." This notion of the eternal possibility of marriage is included in a 15th century enhancement of part of the marriage rite. The priest leads the crowned couple around in a circle three times in their first steps together as a married couple. This came to be known as the Dance of Isaiah due to the hymn sung at that time, "O Isaiah, dance your joy, for the virgin was indeed with child." At the end of this dance, the priest intones, "Accept these their crowns into your kingdom, unsoiled and undefiled, and preserve them without offense to the ages of ages," indicating again the eternal potential of their union. This crowning in the marriage rite is multivalent, as it also symbolizes the self-martyrdom that is marriage, evoking Christ's crown of thorns and the crowns the early Christian martyrs were forced to wear. This symbolism is also eschatological in that it points to the crowns of glory that the martyrs and the saints wear in the kingdom, including married couples who have martyred themselves to each other. Remarriage after widowhood is possible in the Orthodox Church, as I will describe in a moment, but the eternal potential of the marriage union is often taken seriously in a way that precludes remarriage even in those cases. For example, due to the way in which he understood this eschatological quality of marriage, my own father did not remarry after my mother's rather young death, even though he was fortunate enough to have a loving companion in the last years of his life. He took very seriously, as do many Orthodox, the possibility that his first and only marriage crown might be part of his eternal reward. This eternal reward bears on the Orthodox understanding of remarriage, as I will get to in a moment, but I will first discuss how remarriage is generally understood within Orthodoxy. In Orthodoxy, one marriage is understood as not just the ideal, but as the norm, because of the sacramental and potential eternal quality of the union. Divorce is considered to be a failure to honor the sacrament and to reach that eternal union, both on the part of the couple and on the part of their greater community. Divorce is not permitted in Orthodoxy in the same way that sin is not permitted. The sinful unchastity that Christ referred to when advising the multitudes in Matthew is understood broadly in the Orthodox setting. Unchastity can include numerous sins that work against the sacramentality of marriage. Like any sin, the Orthodox Church acknowledges that unchastity exists and has a means of working towards forgiveness and reconciliation in its aftermath. The brokenness of this life is embodied in divorce, but this does not preclude the possibility for healing, a path to deification, even through this particular brokenness. Today, the Orthodox Church, for the most part, deals with the outcome of civil divorce rather than issuing it. Practices vary as to the particulars among Orthodox jurisdictions. Some have an official process of recognizing a civil divorce. Some only require that the divorced speak to their priest or perhaps to their bishop. What is permitted in Orthodoxy is a return to the Eucharist after confession and repentance for divorce and the possibility of a second marriage. Both the canons of the Orthodox Church and its rites address these matters. There's a lot of canonical knowledge and language dedicated to remarriage in the Orthodox Church, and these canons are dosed with a very liberal serving of economia. Here I define economia as the pastoral principle of mercy towards and knowledge of the given human persons involved in a particular situation. For example, in the 4th century, Basil of Caesarea asserted that those who marry for a third time are not to be thrown out of the church, but are instead to do penance. In such cases, the couple might have acquired a civil marriage and then waited a period appointed by their priest before coming to receive the Eucharist together, having their marriage thus sealed by the church. There are many other canons sprinkled throughout the Orthodox Church, the early church, and well into its second millennia that support a period of abstention from communion in the cases of remarriage, including both after divorce and in the instance of a widow remarrying. The Emperor Leo, who, to the continued chagrin of many Orthodox, took civil marriage and divorce out of the purview of the state and placed it onto the mantle of the church for the duration of the Byzantine Empire, may be the reason that Orthodox canons do not allow for a fourth marriage. Leo married a fourth wife after she alone produced him an heir, and he kind of swapped out patriarchs in order for this marriage to be accepted by the church, earning another source for notoriety. Since Leo's time, the maximum of three possible marriages for an Orthodox Christian is universally understood to be an appropriate disciplinary limit. In addition to the canons, the Orthodox rites of marriage also include this principle of economia when it comes to remarriage. Toward the end of the first millennium, a different rite for remarriage was established, which included penitential language around a second, and in some cases a third, marriage. The office for a second marriage, as it is called, survives today and references those in Scripture who were forgiven great sin: Rahab the harlot, the thief on the cross, the publican. And rather than invoking the names of the great scriptural families, as is the case in the first marriage rite, the language of the second marriage rite makes it quite clear that a second marriage is not considered the norm. Quote, "Do thou cleanse the transgressions of thy servants, for unable to bear the heat and burden of the day and the burning of the flesh, they have come to a second communion of marriage." There is no mistaking this rite with the rite of a first marriage. Although the canons and the rites together point to a penitential understanding of remarriage, it's really important to note that this rite is not always practiced as it is written. Although I do know of cases in which the office of a second marriage has been used in its entirety, specifically I know a case where a pair had an adulterous affair with each other, divorced their first spouses, and then married each other, and the second rite was used. I know of far more many cases in the United States where the office of a second marriage has been modified or is not used at all, is replaced by the first marriage rite for second and third marriages. The Orthodox practice of these things tends strongly towards a generous economia. One priest reports that he modifies the second marriage rite because he cannot tolerate the snickering from the audience that is inevitably prompted when the couple before him is characterized as unable to bear the burden and heat of the day. He notes that it is not just the inappropriate laughter that he cannot tolerate, but also the possibility of embarrassing or even shaming the couple, actions that have no place in a sacrament. Another priest includes the prayer of the scriptural sinners, but omits entirely the burning of the flesh prayer. Of the dozens of priests I have anecdotally spoken to, only one cited his comfort with the office for a second marriage. He was a young, newly ordained priest who spoke with relish of his alignment with the canons in his intention to consistently use the second marriage rite regardless of the circumstances. Just as the use of the second marriage rite varies according to economia, so also do the practices of excommunication after divorce. Many priests recommend to the newly divorced that they undergo penitential practices, such as a prayer rule with prostration, or possibly a time of excommunication, or possibly not. Many have completed their efforts before a second marriage is on the horizon, if it ever is, and are not assigned further penance when remarrying. Some priests, from knowing a particular parishioner well, understand the process of divorce as penitential enough in itself. All these decisions are based on discernment about the human persons involved. This reflects the authentic Orthodox practice of oikonomia, which is fundamentally about persons, not principles or rites or laws. There's also a relationship with the Eucharist here. As I noted earlier, proximity to the Eucharist was considered in the early church to be essential and even definitive of the sacraments of ordination and baptism. This is also the case with marriage. The return of the divorced and the remarried to the Eucharist affirms again that these second marriages might be received in the kingdom through the healing and connection with the divine that is possible through the reception of the body and blood of Christ. The cross that stands between Aristophanes and Vigilantia on the nuptial ring that we collectively imagined is a reminder that Christ, the true physician, is at work in their marriage, even if it is a second marriage. Most likely, Aristophanes and Vigilantia were not the only people who were part of their marriage. Most likely, they had children. But I have not mentioned children yet because a discussion of children is exactly what I perceive to be missing from most Orthodox discussions of marriage. It's odd in some ways that children are not often included in written theological reflections on marriage because the marriage rite itself mentions the hope for offspring several times and asks that the couple be made glad with the sight of sons and daughters. The marriage rite is even jokingly referred to as the Orthodox fertility rite because it mentions the couple's fecundity so many times. Orthodox marriages are expected to be open to children, barring mental or physical restraints on childbearing. Orthodoxy provides no universal dictum on family planning or the use of contraception. It seems that most laypersons, theologians, and clergy advocate the view that such matters call not for universal rules, but for oikonomia. Significantly, as much as a truly realized Orthodox marriage ought to be open to children, the Orthodox tradition recognizes that children, even when desired and sought after in love, do not always come. The Church has continuously understood such marriages as in no way sacramentally diminished. The inclusion of children in Orthodox theologies of marriage seems to stop, though, with what I've mentioned so far, with the hope for them and the acknowledged openness to them. Beyond that, there's little contemplation of how children fit into marriage, or how a marriage ought to change once children enter into it. And so I now wish to offer, before I conclude, just a glimpse at ways that children ought to be integrated into Orthodox theologies of marriage. Children can be contemplated within the context of the three qualities of marriage that I've worked with earlier. The act of procreation is rightly understood as a sacramental act, and that it certainly involves an epiphanic moment in the co-creation with God experienced by the parents. Children also share in the Eucharist with their parents. From their infancy in Orthodoxy, they experience the healing powers of communion within the context of their family. And just as there is a potentially eternal quality to the marriage union, there is certainly an eternal quality to parenthood. I will always be my mother's daughter, even though she has already gone to the grave, and my children will forever be my children. This is more than just recorded genealogy. It is a relationship forged in love and reenacted in the Eucharist. But more needs to be said about children within marriage. Earlier, I invoked the crowning of the couple in the Orthodox marriage rite, and I spoke to how it points to their mutual martyrdom. The crowns on the heads of the new couple remind us of their sacrifice to each other. They now live to serve the other person. Now, it can be rightly said that all Christians live to serve other people. But there is something exceptional within the marriage partnership that means these two human beings are now called specifically to serve each other. When children enter the marriage, I propose that the opportunities for this sort of service and martyrdom increase, because now the parents also live to serve their children. And by parents serving their children, I don't wish to evoke images of parents allowing their children tyrannical control of their family. Instead, I mean to evoke the sense of sacrifice that it is to bear and raise children. To parent a child means constantly evaluating and setting aside one's own passions in order to care for and love that child. To parent a child means to be aware of his or her own needs and place them over one's own in a manner that is loving and not authoritarian. This is an ascetical labor. It can be joyful and full of grace, but it is a path of self-denial. This path of self-denial needs to be part of the larger theological picture of marriage and especially integrated into considerations of divorce and remarriage. Although the sacramental bond of marriage is incredibly significant, the care and safety of children in a family should always trump that of adults. Not only do the possibilities for martyrdom increase, but they get reordered upon the appearance of children. Now our martyrdom to our children is ranked first, lest we cause any of them to stumble as Christ admonished us. This martyrdom to our children is one of the greatest challenges of faithfulness in Christian family life. In practical considerations, this means that we might approach marital problems with a different sense. The question of what is best for those most vulnerable among us, our children, should achieve a natural prominence. There are cases where a couple's allegiance to their church's vision of sacramental marriage blinds them to what is safest and best for their children. We ought not let marriage as a sacrament become an idol, such that we ignore the suffering of children in a violent or unsafe household. Instead, we ought to consider orthodox understandings of marriage and create a space for children within marriage, letting them come to us as Christ instructed. In conclusion, the orthodox theological vision of family sees marriage as the sacrament of love, which is nourished and healed in the Eucharist and directed towards the kingdom in both first marriages as well as remarriages. This vision supports the married couple and their challenges of faithfulness, especially when the marriage becomes reoriented to the children born or adopted into it. I like to imagine not just Aristophanes and Vigilantia united in matrimony, but their children joining them in harmony on their shared journey in this life and in the next. Thank you.
I am also so happy to be here. It's been about 20 years since I graduated with my PhD from the University of Southern California down the road there, and also about 20 years since Father Tom Rausch here at LMU gave me my first chance at teaching my own course, which was a course on marriage. And I have been doing a lot of work on marriage and family ever since that time. So you can imagine, those of you who have been following Catholic news, that in the last 2 years, it's been a wonderful time for me as the church has had the Synod of Bishops on the Family in Rome, where bishops were gathering over the last 2 years. All of a sudden, what I've been passionate about was in the news every day at the forefront of the discussions. And what I'm offering here today is a part of my response to that. So on August 5th in 2015, Pope Francis used his general audience to call for mercy for the divorced and remarried. He insisted these people are by no means excommunicated, though their situation contradicts the Christian sacrament. He said it's important they experience the church as a mother, attentive to all, always disposed to listen in encounters. Though those who are divorced and remarried are not formally excommunicated, the Pope suggested that with our current practice, they often feel as if they were. He seemed to be implicitly urging the Synod Fathers to make at least some adaptations in the current ecclesial practice in which divorced and remarried people are not allowed to receive communion. Predictably, conservative Catholic news sources reported this, but they also reminded their readers that John Paul II and Pope Benedict had rejected any sort of liberalizing of the solution, while liberal Catholic news sources emphasized the call for mercy and the Pope's insistent refrain, no closed doors, no closed doors. If technically Pope Francis was not saying anything new, his remarks, like much of the discussion surrounding the synod, were provocative, but they provoked traditional and progressive Catholics in different ways. In my remarks today, I want to do three things. I want to outline these recent developments in Catholic thinking. I want to suggest that underneath all this talk about communion are actually theological debates about the nature of indissolubility and the workings of grace in sacramental marriage. And finally, I'd like to offer a few pastoral suggestions that may provide a way forward as Catholics seek to remain faithful to their tradition in the context of very difficult situations. My hope is to provide a common ground path. This has been my project for the last 5 years at least, to seek common ground, but for all those who seek to strengthen marriage, decrease divorce, and practice mercy. So first, recent developments. In a speech at the Vatican in 2014 that later became the very short, notorious book called The Gospel of the Family, Cardinal Walter Casper offered a moderate challenge to current teaching. Some Catholic theologians have been challenging the teaching on indissolubility in a much more radical way, at least since the 1970s. They've been arguing that indissolubility should be understood as an ideal. We want couples' marriages never to dissolve, rather than a reality they can't dissolve. Casper claims to accept the teaching, but argues for mercy at the pastoral level on a case-by-case basis. He argues that historically, the church has always sought a way between rigorism and laxity, and he gives priority to Jesus's praxis of mercy. He contends, however far a human being may fall, he or she never falls deeper than God's mercy can reach. He asks, can we really maintain this practice of exclusion from the Eucharist and still claim that we really believe in the forgiveness of sins? Soon after the Gospel of the Family was published, two theologians from the John Paul II Institute for the Study of Marriage and Family in Rome published a much longer book with the exact same title, the implication being this is the real gospel of the family. So in over 300 pages responding to all of Casper's arguments. True mercy, in their view, means calling people away from the sin of adultery, and which they see as being the situation in remarriage, and toward conversion. They argue that the pastoral teaching cannot change because any spousal relationship apart from the first marriage will always be adulterous. They hold that there is no room for mercy in persistent infidelity, even if the person has repented of having caused it. During the 2014 Synod of Bishops on Marriage and Family, in a report on the dialogue in process, the report created quite a stir because it suggested that the bishops were considering a way forward for remarried Catholics. Perhaps some were claiming that in some extenuating circumstances, the state of sin in remarriage might look a little bit different. Or perhaps we could rely on the law of gradualness, which might require mercy because as we wait for people to gradually make their way toward greater virtue. However, in the final report in 2014, these references to gradualism were dropped, and instead the pain that divorce causes was emphasized and spouses were called to forgiveness. But those paragraphs were among only a handful not to receive majority support. So the bishops vote on all the different paragraphs, but these remained controversial, and that suggested that there was still ongoing disagreement. Then in the fall of 2015, when the bishops gathered to complete the work of the synod, the issue of communion surfaced once again. The bishops were meeting in language groups, and the German bishops emerged with a controversial proposal to allow communion in binding second marriage after consultation with a priest, confession, and discernment that reception of the sacrament was appropriate again. But could the Synod Fathers accept this? In their final report to Pope Francis, the Synod Fathers said of the divorced and remarried, "They're baptized, they're brothers and sisters, the Holy Spirit has given them gifts and charisms for the good of all, the church needs them." They affirmed that various forms of exclusion must be overcome, and indicated the need for discernment in difficult cases, which seemed to indicate that they were accepting what the German bishops had said. However, they didn't actually say the words communion or Eucharist, which means that it's up to Pope Francis to make a final decision in a document that should be issued any day now. That's where we are. Second, what's at stake here? I would argue that there are lots of issues swirling around, but what really is going on is that we're having a debate about, or we're not having a debate, about the nature of indissolubility and the workings of grace. The doctrine of indissolubility for Catholics is claimed as the unquestioned starting point of the conversation. And yet, most Catholics, most ordinary Catholics, probably believe that marriages, not that marriages are indissoluble, but that they ought to be. Most seek love for a lifetime. I am not convinced that Catholics are rampant individualists who want nothing more than to trade up for a better model spouse when things get tough. Beyond the most difficult cases, those who divorce believe their marital unhappiness is an indication of some fundamental flaw in the marriage. At some point, the suffering becomes too much. They experience their marriages irreparably broken, and they feel justified, though certainly not guiltless, in ending it. The source of the Catholic Church's teaching on indissolubility, like all other churches, is Jesus' words in the New Testament, which are blunt and uncompromising, with the notable exception of the notoriously difficult to interpret exception clause that appears only in the Gospel of Matthew. John Meyer, along with a lot of other biblical scholars, believes that this phrase is not from Jesus. Yet many theologians worry about trying to draw a divorce ethic just from Jesus' words, when diversity in the New Testament text suggests that maybe even in the early church, the struggle was unresolved. And it seems that most Christian churches do not strictly adhere to the words of Jesus, even if we interpret those words broadly. Protestants, mainline and evangelical, build on the exception clause and allow couples to discern exceptions in difficult cases. Catholics take the clause to refer to sexual immorality or incest, but then open that up as a way for the church to discern cases in which first marriages are null and also accept separation of bed and board. In all these situations, it seems that that Christians try to balance faithfulness to Jesus' strong teaching with practices that allow for mercy. Beyond Scripture, Catholics oppose divorce because they believe that when two people marry, as in Genesis, they become two in one flesh. An unbreakable bond is created between them through vows and consummation. And today that looks a little bit different because the way we think about marriage has evolved in, along with our understanding of personalism and companionate marriage. So when the Synod Fathers talk about marriage and indissolubility, they say indissolubility represents a personal response to a profound desire for mutual and enduring love, a never-ending love, which becomes a choice and a gift of oneself. A gift made by each spouse to the other, sealing the couple's relationship to God himself and all that God entrusts to them. Though troubles are acknowledged, which is good, there's an insistence that if couples stay committed, they will be sustained by the grace of Christ and the sacrament. Their marriage will endure, and it will be true. It will be a true life-giving relationship, not just a juridical bond. That's our contemporary theology of indissolubility. For progressive Catholics, though, it's precisely this contemporary vision of marriage as total self-giving that makes it more difficult to see a marriage when one spouse has abandoned the other, or abuse or addiction destroys the relationship, when infidelity is persistent, or even when spouses live in the same house while hardly interacting or interacting badly. They ask, where is the marriage that is supposed to endure? In these situations, some theologians affirm indissolubility as an ideal with exceptions or a commitment that ordinarily binds but in tragic circumstances must be broken. But more conservative theologians counter that total self-giving is an ongoing task that human beings take up with God's help, and separation is a remedy only in rare cases. Sacramental marriage, they say, is objectively indissoluble, no matter how difficult. It's a union human beings cannot end on their own initiative. Those who endure in difficult marriages or even the loneliness of separation are not abandoned by God or the church, but sheltered in the undying marriage bond that remains a sign and a source of mercy and a real symbol, even in the difficulty, a real symbol of Christ's victory over death. Is there a way to talk about this divide? Perhaps we could begin by acknowledging that as a description of reality, indissolubility seems both true and false. Surely married couples are united in ways that no two other people are. They share a home, a bed, a daily life, and hopes for the future, if only for a time. Even in the worst marriages, is it possible that separating couples might be able to say, something of this marriage endures? Being with my spouse shaped me, informed me, for better or for worse, I will never be quite the same. Even the best of couples might acknowledge that they grew into one flesh union over time, unevenly, imperfectly. Indissolubility is both a reality larger than their efforts and an ongoing task demanding their participation. Those with biological children can see their one flesh union take flesh. Those who birth or adopt children can see the ways their children are shaped by each of them and their union, and how their children in turn shape them individually and as a couple. Yet sometimes the dissolved and dissolving parts of a marriage are profound. Some would argue that this account gives too little attention to God's promise of fidelity and its ability to transform our limited promises. Nicholas Healy gives voice to this claim in a recent important article on Communio, arguing that while personal faith and love are necessary to marriage, expectations for human beings are pretty minimal. God takes care of the rest, which means indissolubility is a supreme gift of mercy, whereby divine love indwells human love and allows this love to grow beyond itself, to participate in God's love and faithfulness. This grace enables those who exchange wedding vows to say in truth, I pledge my life to you in good times and in bad, in sickness and in health, unto death, and to know those words are true. But how does God's grace function? Right? A document for the synod speaks of the grace of the sacrament that is available to help spouses in Christian marriage. Yet theologians worry about this understanding of grace, which seems kind of pre-Vatican II. It seems to assume that grace is in this bank and then we can make withdrawals. And yet we acknowledge that grace doesn't work automatically. It seems difficult to believe that God gives this advantage to those who are in sacramental marriage but denies it to everyone else. Rather, some argue grace is God's love that is always being poured out and offered to human beings. We know this love in human relationship, especially marriage. So in this framework, Catholic spouses don't suddenly find their relationship problems solved, but in hanging on through suffering and choosing to empty themselves in order to be as much as possible the spouse their partner needs and desires, they often find a strength they didn't know they had. If marriage is, as my friend David McCarthy writes, structured to accommodate dysfunction, I love that, right? It can sometimes seem that in spite of our imperfect efforts, God is present, transforming our marriage into something more than we could ever make ourselves. Yet still one might ask, how imperfect can these efforts be? What if only one spouse makes an effort? Can God always work with us and around us in spite of us? How long must we wait to find out? Could some marriages be more dissolved than undissolved? These explorations are controversial within my own tradition, and they may be controversial here today. And I hope that theological conversation is going to be ongoing. I wonder, however, if we could work at the pastoral level and in that way move toward common ground on divorce and remarriage. So the final part is on this potential for common ground. More progress on divorce and remarriage might be possible if we turned attention from the seemingly intractable theological issues to what I call the space between, the space of the local or communal. We know that some people want more flexibility and others want a strong reaffirmation of Catholic teaching. Both sides say they want to honor mercy and truth. But what if we started talking together about what we might do to strengthen marriage, reduce divorce, and care for those affected by divorce, those in fragile and broken families? The Synod documents rightly suggest that divorce is a serious problem, and yet current trends may not be as irreversible as people think. Divorce rates are at historic highs worldwide, but in the U.S., they peaked in the 1980s and have been declining since then. Since data on the importance of intact marriages for kids has been available, especially more educated and privileged adults in the U.S. have fewer children before marriage and divorce much less often. Catholics still divorce at a rate lower than other Americans. About 36% of American adults divorce, but only 28% of Catholics. Most divorces, about two-thirds, according to many social scientists, occur in low-conflict marriages and are potentially avoidable. The claim that when unhappy parents divorce, kids will usually be happier, still repeated by some progressive Catholics, is at the very least highly contested. There is strong longitudinal data from social scientists documenting the long-lasting negative effects of divorce on children, though it's important to note that most eventually rebound. Less well-established, still significant, is data showing that divorce does not always make adults happy, that on average, children fare no better in step-families than in single-parent families, on average, that second and subsequent marriages are less stable than first marriages. All of this is important to bear in mind as we think about what changes in pastoral practice are most urgent. So we've been thinking in Catholic circles about communion and about changes in annulment procedure. I suggest we might want to think about different kinds of pastoral practices to strengthen marriage. I have three suggestions. One, there is a real need to welcome adults and children from broken families who suffer the wounds of divorce and the pain of exclusion. Often, we know from the sociological data, these families stop going to church regularly, and their kids grow up less connected to religious institutions than do other young adults. Pope Francis is right to say that regardless of official Catholic teaching, many people feel as if they are excommunicated. Many do not see a place for imperfect families in parishes. Certainly, we should be able to think creatively about how parishes can better welcome those who divorce and remarry and their children. Second, serving these families will mean more than welcome. It will mean providing counseling for children, many of whom experience the effects of divorce for years after the event. Many struggle in their own relationships in young adulthood. They have greater uncertainty in their faith and are at greater risk for divorce themselves. It's important to be honest about the costs many children bear and to be clear that annulment and remarriage do not necessarily diminish the pain. In a recent article in America, a group of adult children whose parents had divorced expressed their opposition to welcoming the divorced and remarried to communion. The church's discipline was, for them, a just and merciful recognition of the pain they experienced. Though other adult children of divorce responded vigorously to the article with a plea for mercy for their parents. Whether or not the communion rule changes, churches can and should do more to meet the needs of those affected by family fragility and divorce. Currently, most couples who struggle in their marriages do not seek counsel from their Catholic pastors, and the counseling they seek from others is often insufficient. In their final report, the Synod Fathers claim that experience shows when people work on their marriages that there will be satisfactory outcomes, and yet they present no data on this. And the fact is that many try and don't succeed. And yet we can look at, again, at social science to see that there's some evidence that couples aren't putting in an adequate amount of time, and also that many counselors are not trained to work with couples, and perhaps there's growth that can happen in this area, right? It's also important to know that researchers suggest that couples with difficult marriages who stay together don't differ all that significantly from those who part. And to know that all couples experiencing highs and lows, and most who stay married over time, even those who tell researchers, "I am really dissatisfied with my marriage," eventually see highs after the lows. As the Synod Fathers recognize, if we care about reducing divorce, providing more resources for married couples who struggle is crucial. Finally, we need to provide more witness of marriage in parishes. Most people still want forever marriages, and they know that that involves joy and sacrifice. Churches seeking to form people for committed, indissoluble marriages can't just recognize silver and golden anniversaries with a mass or a banquet. That is what we currently do, as far as I can see. Good, but yeah, no, not enough. Parishes need to be places where the stories of lifelong marriage are told, where those who wish to marry and those who are married see spouses affirm indissolubility as a growing relational reality for two people who keep trying to be the one for each other while remaining open to what God is doing in them, in spite of their imperfect efforts and lack of expertise. We need spaces for those stories to be told. Conclusion. The documents for the recent synod included this question for consideration. How can people be made to understand that Christian marriage corresponds to the original plan of God, and to see this as something that will fulfill them rather than confine them? I suggest above that all marriages are truly, partially, but incompletely indissoluble, and that grace works despite us, but not without limits. Some will no doubt disagree, but I would guess that we all share the strong presumption against divorce and the goal of stronger marriage and fewer divorces. We can find common ground at the practical level. One might say this is a cop-out, but I suggest that if churches try to help struggling couples, welcome and serve those who divorce, and celebrate lifelong marriage in more credible ways, more couples will be able to affirm more of the teaching on indissolubility and grace and ask the really difficult questions. How costly would it be for us to stay together or part? How much of our marriage remains? How much potential is there for growth or repair? Could God be calling on us to stay despite the pain? Is there any hope that if we trust in God, we'll find strength and grow our marriage? I don't pretend that those questions are easy, but they are, in my judgment, necessary even for those who wish to acknowledge the legitimacy of civil divorce, annulment, and second marriage. Pope Francis opened a conversation on this topic that remains a source of great pain for many. The documents of the recent synod include multiple references, one of the great contributions of the synod, I think, to this practice of accompaniment, which is defined as encouraging a deep respect for the other and walking with people on their journey. It's a very promising opening, but the divide on the theological issues at stake is wide, and the urgency of responding to the cry for mercy coming from the divorced, the remarried, and their children is undeniable. Perhaps building a better theology of marriage and divorce from below through church practices is not avoiding the question, but working out solutions that can assist more people in their efforts to be faithful, even as we continue to seek agreement across serious differences on the theology of marriage and divorce.
Good morning. And I would like to add my thanks and sense of honor to my two co-panelists here. Thank you so much for having me here, especially for bringing me from so far away, sight unseen, to participate in this colloquium today. I would like to begin my reflections on the challenges of faithfulness for the Christian family in 21st century American culture with two passages from the strange and stirring vision that concludes our Holy Scriptures, the book of Revelation. First, from chapter 5, verses 9 and 10, which report the praise of the assembly in heaven. "Worthy are you to take the scroll and to open its seals, for you were slain, and by your blood you bought people for God from every tribe and language and people and nation. And you have made them a kingdom and priests to our God, and they shall reign on the earth." And second, from chapter 18, verses 11 to 13, describing the fallout of the downfall of the great city of Babylon. "And the merchants of the earth weep and mourn for her, since no one buys their cargo anymore, cargo of gold, silver, jewels, pearls, fine linen, purple cloth, silk, scarlet cloth, all kinds of scented wood, all kinds of articles of ivory, all kinds of articles of costly wood, bronze, iron, and marble, cinnamon, spice, incense, myrrh, frankincense, wine, oil, fine flour, wheat, cattle and sheep, horses and chariots, and bodies and souls of human beings." Revelation portrays here the stark contrast between the economy of God and the economy of fallen human civilization. Both are economies, to be sure. There is nothing inherently wrong with the language of trade or exchange. The astonishing uniqueness of the divine exchange, though, is that it does not take place at a distance, mediated by money. Jesus, the Lamb, sheds his own blood as the one price that buys back all the lost from every tribe and language and people and nation. And instead of putting his rightful possessions to work as slave labor, Jesus crowns them as kings and ordains them as priests. But this is not the way of Babylon. All of chapter 18 recounts her downfall, and yet, for all the relief that her evil ways are at an end, you can't miss the undercurrent of sadness as well. Human civilization is a magnificent thing. In Babylon's case, true, it had become so corrupted that, as such, it was beyond redemption. A new city, namely the New Jerusalem, would have to come and take its place. But it would be hard-hearted only to exult in Babylon's failure to be what it might have been. A significant part of its failure was how its business of trade, not evil in itself, degenerated into horror. The long list that I just read lulls us into a false sense of security, encouraging us to picture in our minds the splendor that once was, until it abruptly comes to its shocking conclusion, the bodies and souls of human beings. Babylon's trade acknowledged no limits. Everything was for sale. Everything. Even human bodies. Even human souls. I read these words as an American and hear an indictment of my own culture. To be sure, after many years living outside of the United States and travels to many far-flung corners of the earth, I have a renewed appreciation for this country's gifts and strengths, not least economic. We are structured to reward individuals' creativity and hard work instead of punishing it with endless bureaucracy and taxes, as in other developed nations. And we have a level of social and financial mobility that is the envy of impoverished lands and peoples. I no longer take these goods for granted. But I can also no longer ignore the extent to which our culture is defined by its economy, by Babylon's definition of trade, instead of the Lamb's definition of trade. Everything is for sale here, even human bodies, even human souls. The impact on family and sexuality is clear. And indeed, the chief metaphor for Babylon's wickedness is porneia, sexual immorality. Now, it is no secret that marriage at all, much less marriage for life, is getting harder and harder for Americans. This is not because people today are, as often accused, less moral than previous generations or more self-indulgent. I don't believe that. The lengths our people will go to in, for example, dieting or mastering computer coding languages or competing for scholarships or TV appearances proves that there is plenty of drive, devotion, and self-denial. It's rather that, in addition to suffering the harm done by their parents, maybe even their grandparents' bad sexual choices, our Americans have been so suffused in the logic of never closing off any options, always having the opportunity to trade in, buy more, and get a full refund, that few have gained the ability to pair up with another human being and stick with that person regardless of his or her fluctuating market value. And the person who doesn't have someone else to trust through thick and thin is going to be more vulnerable to the market's insinuations about the good, the true, and the beautiful available now. Operators are standing by. This is a social illness as much as a personal weakness, if not more so. What ensues is compound interest on psychosocial disorder. It would be so nice and tidy if there was some single action or person to blame. But as in the case of Babylon, it is not trade itself, but trade out of control, trade without limits. Every purchase that I justify, every treat I award myself because I deserve it, every whim I pursue because I can afford to, each of these choices, tiny, may be individually innocent, but collectively, cumulatively, over the course of a life, over the breadth of a society, they conform me, us, to the logic of consumption. Advertising gives me the language to speak not only of products, but of myself. Competition spurs my creativity, but also gradually reduces the people around me to accessories and prizes. Other human beings become the logical conclusion to the catalog of saleable goods, as in Revelation 18. Many have observed that the scripture has far more to say about money than about sex. The usual inference drawn is that sex is less important than money. But I suspect that the real lesson is that if money is not managed aright, then sex will become only a subset of money. Human beings will become commodities instead of infinitely valuable images of God. How do we resist this human trafficking, which is most egregious in the sexual sale of bodies, yet I would argue lies on a continuum with many other misuses of human lives? Faithfulness in family life will only be possible when we are operating from the logic of a totally different economy. At this point, I would like to turn from critique of the economy of Babylon to an exploration of the economy of the Lamb, which I will do with the help of Martin Luther. Those who wish to pursue the critique of Babylon will find a good guide in Luther also, who relentlessly attacked the economic abuses of his day, not merely in indulgences, as he is most famous for, but far more extensively and throughout his career, the abuses of the secular economy. But here, I will stick with Luther's moving depiction of the economy of the Lamb, which can be summarized in the expression, the joyful exchange. Now, the term didn't originate with him. He learned it from his mentor, Johannes Staupitz, who had in turn found it in Augustine as the Latin term commercium admirabile. You can hear the root of our word commerce in it. Up until Luther, the main use of the term was to describe the humbling of the divine word in human flesh in order to grant everlasting life to human creatures. As Athanasius famously put it, the divine became human so that the human could become divine. And this is the foundation for Luther too, the sine qua non of salvation, as expressed so beautifully in Philippians 2. Christ Jesus, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of human beings. It was a particular concern of Luther's Christology to emphasize the full communication of attributes, or the exchange of the divine and human natures with each other in the one person of Christ. This means that all of the divine attributes are granted to the human Christ, while all of the human attributes are granted to the divine Christ. So we can say the eternal Son of God truly hungers, thirsts, tires, suffers, and dies, while the mortal Son of Man truly heals, prophesies, exorcises, feeds, forgives, and rises to everlasting life. This is the first exchange and the basis for all the others, the exchange between the human and divine in the person of Jesus Christ. But for Luther, this dogmatic inheritance did not disclose its full wonder and joy until he grasped the second exchange that emerges directly out of the first, the exchange between me and my Lord, which takes place through his promise and my faith. Just as the Lord does not buy me via the medium of money, but with his own blood, so promise and faith are not externalized realities creating a buffer zone between God and human. They are rather the very encounter between God and human. God is in his word of promise. God is his word of promise. And I cannot receive this word through something external to myself, even through such otherwise laudable things as religious practice or intellectual assent or good works, but only through believing and trusting in this promise spoken directly to me. This faith is such an intimate appropriation of the word that Luther, with much of the mystical tradition, has to use a marital metaphor. He says, it unites the soul with Christ as a bride is united with her bridegroom, just as we hear in the Song of Songs or Bernard of Clairvaux. Luther extrapolates from the legal and economic realities of marriage, in which husband and wife give to one another everything they own, even their bodies, to illustrate the new reality in faith. The spousal exchange with Christ through faith gives believers the right to boast of and glory in all the good things of the Son of God. As Luther therefore describes the second joyful exchange, Christ is full of grace, life, and salvation. The soul is full of sins, death, and damnation. Now let faith come between them, and sins, death, and salvation will be Christ's, while grace, life, and salvation will be the soul's. For if Christ is a bridegroom, he must take upon himself the things which are his bride's and bestow upon her the things that are his. If he gives her his body and very self, how shall he not give her all that is his? And if he takes the body of the bride, how shall he not take all that is hers? So, therefore, it is every Christian's right to boast, I am his, and he is mine. Again, from the Song of Songs. I claim the righteousness he has offered me freely as a gift and stand joyfully before God, no longer torn away from his presence by the weight of my sins. But this could well become a privatized thing, a secret transaction between God and me, exclusive of the rest of the human race. This is why, for Luther, there is a third joyful exchange, building on the first two and necessary to the whole and holistic portrait of salvation. as Luther succinctly put it, I will therefore give myself as a Christ to my neighbor, just as Christ offered himself to me. Salvation thus does not stop at my renewed relationship with God, but is the wellspring of the renewed relationship with my neighbor. Again, Luther. From Christ, the good things have flowed and are flowing into us. He has so put on us and acted for us as if he had been what we are. From us, they flow on to those who have need of them, so that I should lay before God my faith and my righteousness, that they may cover and intercede for the sins of my neighbor, which I take upon myself, and so labor and serve in them as if they were my very own. That is what Christ did for us. This is true love and the genuine rule of a Christian life. Love is true and genuine where there is true and genuine faith. In sum, the Christian life is a life of exchanges. We conclude, therefore, says Luther, that a Christian lives not in himself, but in Christ and in his neighbor. Otherwise, he is not a Christian. He lives in Christ through faith, in his neighbor through love. In this way, the old individual versus community dichotomy is completely overturned. To be an individual is to participate in exchanges of love with others. To be a community is to be occupied with each individual through the bonds of love. And just as these exchanges dispense with egotistical self-centeredness, they also dispense with egotistical selflessness. For one who has no self is incapable of loving or being loved. God's community, the Lamb's economy, is an abundance of selves busy in the commerce of kindness, making transactions of faith and love at all times, where greed is transformed into generosity and stinginess into single-minded devotion. So to conclude now, how do we bring the economy of the Lamb, this cheerful activity of joyful exchanges, to bear upon the economy of Babylon? For Luther, marriage and family stood at the heart of both the divine and the human economies. Before all other institutions, notably including government and religion, God created the fellowship of marriage in the pairing of Adam and Eve, bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. To be a parent was to hold the highest office and be deserving of the highest honor on earth, more than emperor or bishop. Among Luther's other reforms was to affirm the blessed economy of marriage, to teach young people to value it and desire it, to teach spouses to love one another. He even remarks that love in marriage will render the commandment of chastity unnecessary, because in such circumstances it will occur spontaneously. Husband lives in his wife, wife in her husband, they for their children, and their children in them, not to mention all the other members of the household. The Luthers themselves took in at least 12 children of their extended families, in addition to the 6 they conceived and bore. The church resides first and foremost in this ecclesia domestica, or domestic church. Faithfulness to God and faithfulness to one another stem from the joyful exchanges that start in the home and radiate outward, infecting all of society with their kindness and care. For this reason, Luther argued that all political authority is derivative of parental authority. It exists to care for the people of a society with the same concern as a father cares for his own children. It is not selective and doesn't play favorites, but extends to each and every person the concern befitting a fellow child of God bought by the blood of the Lamb. Thus, for Luther, the gospel calls not for privatized communes of righteousness, tiny or insular economies of supposed purity, but for the messy and troublesome business of bringing the economy of the lamb right into the heart of Babylon through the public witness of the family. Babylon would like nothing better than to keep the lamb as one subculture among many, not least of all for the new advertising and manufacturing opportunities it opens up, all the while leaving the logic of the competitive marketplace unchallenged. What then, we should ask, lies at the heart of our Babylon's corruption of family and sexuality? Tracing out the logic of Luther's account of salvation, which finally means a real face-to-face encounter with God and a real face-to-face encounter with the neighbor, forming a self that is ecstatic in the deepest sense of the word, I infer that what our Babylonian culture fears above all is real persons. It wants anything but that face-to-face encounter, that entanglement with the infinite complexity of an actual human soul animating a particular human body. Nothing would so expose the shallowness of our Babylonian economy and its systemic lies in the form of marketing and our voluntary blindness to its cost in human lives and the earth itself, like having to reckon with a real live human being. The avoidance of the person is obvious and easily and appropriately criticized in things like sex trafficking, prostitution, pornography, and abortion, all of which depersonalize sexuality and require the absolute elimination of the family. But these are manifestations of a deeper and more subtle fear of the person that pervades all of our society and touches even on those of us who would scrupulously avoid participation in such obvious evils. The same fear of the person is seen in the way we are taught to construct ourselves out of purchased items, making of our souls a magpie's nest, opting in or out of trends, positioning ourselves in our tribes with our particular costumes, foods, moral codes, fads, and ads. God forbid we should ever be left alone with our naked selves, bodies unsculpted, souls laid bare in all their sins and weaknesses and desires and peculiarities. God forbid we should ever admit to being creatures who must receive before we can act, who must be babies before we can be adults, who must be vulnerable before we can be champions. What is more devastating to the old Adam than giving up the illusion of heroism, independence, and righteousness? Even we Christians are very susceptible to these temptations. Even we are lured by a simplified facade of self, sanctified and on the right side of history. We are at our worst when we declare what is right and wrong while holding real persons at arm's length. I believe that religion for most people in our country starts and ends with ethics, trying to be a good person and doing the right thing. There is no more disastrous strategy we could adopt than giving in to this tendency by asserting a sexual ethic divorced from its grounding in the person of Jesus Christ. At most, with that, we could hope to accrue a host of converted legalists. If we are to be faithful to the gospel and to the blessing of family as God's first institution, then we have to declare not a different and better law, but first and foremost, a different and better gospel. We have to reach past the fear of meeting real persons and of being real persons with the good news of a God who turns with favor upon real persons in all their failures and vulnerabilities. God demands not in the first place a perfect self, but a real self. A real self he can redeem, as Jesus did in his conversations with sinners and demoniacs and prostitutes and centurions. A false self he can only expose, as Jesus did in his confrontations with Pharisees and scribes and the rich young man. Real persons can form a new community, as did Priscilla and Aquila, the married couple of Acts who were teachers and leaders. But false persons, with their illusions of sanctity, can only destroy themselves and others, as did Ananias and Sapphira with their pretension of greater generosity than they were really capable of. The only option that does not lie open to us is to remain our own. Either Babylon will buy and own us, body and soul, or the Lamb will. So many of our American people think they will find freedom apart from their own real selves, apart from other persons, and apart from the three persons who are together one God. In truth, they only end up at the end of a long list of consumer goods. So let us then bear in our own honest, broken, unvarnished persons the good news that we too have been bought, but bought by the Lamb, who has made us not slaves, but kings and priests. And let us examine ourselves to see how we have colluded with the economy of Babylon, even in subtle ways, repenting and turning again to the ecstatic life of true neighborliness with God and one another. Only in this joyful exchange can we hope to be given back the earth and its wonders, the family and its blessings, sexuality and its delights, but above all, fellowship with the triune God. Thank you.
Always happens at the symposia of the Huffington Ecumenical Institute. We have three wonderful presentations that made us think, that moved our hearts, that inspired us to action, and that also had common themes: economy, person, personalism, the Trinitarian relationship, but also distinct paths from the distinct traditions that we bring together today. So please join me again in thanking Julie Hanlon Rubio, Sarah Henlicky Wilson, and Carrie Frederick Frost. We are now invited to have some response. I think our respondents are going to have to approach, and I will need to introduce them, but perhaps we have a moment to stretch or stand up, but don't go far. Our first respondent today we're privileged to have is Father Alan Figueroa Deck of the Society of Jesus, who is the rector of the Jesuit community here at Loyola Marymount University. He is distinguished scholar in pastoral theology and Latino studies at the Bellarmine College of Liberal Arts. He has doctorates in Latin American studies and theology, and he's the author of many works, and including a recent book on Pope Francis. He is also one of the, I think it is fair to say, one of the founders of U.S. Hispanic Latino theology and the first executive director of the Cultural Diversity Secretariat of the United States Catholic Conference of Bishops. So Father Alan will be our first respondent. Our second respondent is Father Michael Khoury, who is the rector of St. Catherine Greek Orthodox Church in my home city, Redondo Beach. So we are, he's an artist and iconographer, which, as you all know, is a very, very important role in Orthodox tradition. And some of his icons can be seen here in California, in Dunlap and San Juan Capistrano. His doctoral degree is from Fuller Theological Seminary. His area of specialization is Orthodox spirituality. He is an author, retreat leader, and speaker. He's also on the advisory board of the Huffington Ecumenical Institute. So at this point, I would like to invite Father Alan Figueroa Deck to respond.
Good morning, everyone. Can everybody hear me? Good. The subject of today's symposium yields much food for thought for the pastoral theologian. Questions and concerns about Christian marriage and family life have to be among the most pressing ones that the human race faces in the third millennium. My reflection on the three conferences, which I really think have been absolutely superb, excellent, wonderful, my reflection takes the reform of Pope Francis in the spirit of the Second Vatican Council as a point of reference and a useful, I hope, a useful lens for comment and analysis on today's subject. I begin with what I think is most fundamental about Francis's remarkable renewal of the Roman Catholic Church in the spirit of Vatican II, a renewal that we are living through as I speak, and why this renewal or reform is so pertinent to our conversation about Christian family life and faithfulness and marriage. In a word, Francis is moving the church away from Western European Catholicism and historic Protestantism's predominant focus on ideas, doctrines, and propositions of the faith toward a sustained, open, and honest encounter with reality and life in all its grandeur, pathos, and frequent ambiguity. This Pope is committed to bringing the gospel to life. Some have referred to this as a movement from ideology to performance. Now, please don't get me wrong. I'm not saying that he's moving away from what the church teaches or from doctrine or from our tradition. But I am saying that he's putting those things in a slightly different place in terms of how we think and how we proceed. This movement is one of the more obvious indications of Pope Francis's roots in the rich soil of Latin American Catholicism, which more than 50 years ago officially committed itself to the principle, simple one, a simple principle, but hugely consequential pastoral one, about the appropriateness of method, a method that we popularly call see, judge, act. A method which places the emphasis on induction and not deduction. Pope Francis has more than hinted this to us with his assertion that reality is more important than ideas. One way to understand this Pope's pursuit of Vatican II's unfinished business is to say that he seeks to retrieve the true pastorality of theology, rescuing it from the deadening grip of what has been called the Cartesian cogito. Remember Descartes? I think, therefore I am. Okay. The obsession of the Western world, including the church itself, over the past five centuries with a rationality that fails to incarnate the Christian message in the whole person, the whole human person, and, to use Sarah Wilson's term, real persons. He is also giving pause to all those in church leadership who, not infrequently, act like doctors of the law and Pharisees rather than real pastors of the flock. What this means concretely for our subject is that a good starting point must be the human reality of marriage and fidelity and family life, not its idealization, much less its romanticization. And this, not out of any disdain for a Christian understanding of marriage and family, or a dismissal of the light that revelation and tradition and church teaching sheds on these realities, but rather out of the conviction grounded on the gospel itself and the best practices of Christians over the ages that in the real order of things, love is demonstrated in action more than in words, and that the church evangelizes best when it gives witness to what it believes by what it does, more than by what it preaches or formulates in its writings. I was hungry, and you gave me food. Thirsty, and you gave me drink. Naked, and you clothed me. The pastorality of all theology requires that the living church pay attention to both the content of the gospel and to its exercise in the world as it is, not just as it should be. Knowing a reality as it is not only a matter for philosophy or epistemology, it is also a matter of paying attention to history and to human sciences, to sociology, economics, yes, politics, and cultural anthropology. The human sciences help contextualize our understanding of culture and its many expressions, including marriage and whatever is meant by family. Knowledge of culture in its deepest anthropological sense constitutes the bedrock of the contemporary Catholic Church's understanding of its very identity and mission to evangelize, as the Church has insisted over and over again from Gaudium et Spes, Paul VI's Evangelii Nuntiandi, John Paul II's Redemptoris Missio, and Pope Francis' Evangelii Gaudium. So that's the lens. So that's what I take out of what Pope Francis is bringing to this kind of a conversation. Of course, I think he's bringing a lot of other things too, but I wanted to point that out. So now I want to turn to those three wonderful presentations that we've just heard. Carrie Frederick Frost's presentation can be viewed, I think, through the lens of Pope Francis' pastoral emphasis. Her exposition of the Eastern Orthodox tradition on marriage and divorce suggested to me that perhaps, overall, that Christian heritage, I mean the Eastern Orthodox one, the Eastern churches, that of the Eastern Catholic churches, has found ways to practically deal with the messiness of marriage that are faithful to the gospel, but also responsive to the reality of life. Carrie tells us about the economia, the pastoral context within which Orthodoxy seeks to respond to the needs of the faithful. Carrie tells us that, quote, there is no one rigid theological understanding of marriage within Orthodoxy. Thank God. And that kind of a situation becomes more and more important as we move into a pluralistic world, huh? Where one theological take will never be adequate. This makes eminent sense to me from what we know about the Eastern Church's principle of lex orandi, lex credendi, whereby the sacred liturgy becomes the principal means of teaching and the seedbed of doctrine. Effectively, the truths of faith are expressed symbolically, ritually, in narrative form, in story form, rather than in propositions, in catechisms, and canonical formulations. We hear about Orthodoxy's threefold approach to marriage, first as sacrament or mystery, second as intimately linked to the Eucharist, and third as having an eternal potential. This highly symbolic rather than discursive approach to church teaching embedded in the community's worship is performative and it is polyvalent. Thus, it leaves space, it has room to be applied to the complex and often ambiguous situations of real life. This approach is very wise and it contrasts to the Western Catholic theological approach that gives pride of place to rational analysis and legalities. I think Carrie's paper demonstrates that the Christian church has a remarkable and beautiful resource in the Orthodox tradition that offers ancient and yet strangely contemporary, and will I say even postmodern resources for accompanying the faithful in the challenging journey of marriage and family. Then we have Julie Hanlon Rubio, who walks us through the differing points of view about communion for the divorced and the remarried that have surfaced before, during, and after last October's extraordinary synod on the family. Julie highlights the major issues around this controverted question. She rightly identifies the neuralgic point as the teaching regarding the indissolubility of marriage. She makes the point, however, that this teaching can be understood as an ideal to be lived up to, or as an absolute, not perhaps as an absolute requirement. She then provides several examples of how differing theological approaches, what she calls traditionalist and revisionist, navigate this complicated issue. To enlighten her reflection, Rubio also cites social science that provide context and bring the discussion down to the level of real experience. In doing so, she provides a broader vision of what really is at play in this question of indissolubility. Matters like how divorce affects children, how it affects the happiness of divorcees, and so on. Her final word on the way forward in the resolution of this matter is to suggest that a truly pastoral approach is of the essence. We need one. This means bracketing our norms and juridical concerns in order to accompany those who struggle with marriage and divorce and all its consequences. This means helping couples truly discern where the Lord, who never abandons them, may be leading them, which may be in the direction of tapping more into the grace that will provide the strength and the grit necessary to preserve this indissolubility. Julie's remarks remind me that the ideal of indissolubility is what Jesus taught and which the best tradition of the church promotes. Effectively doing that in the real world requires the ability to enter into a world of people who struggle, to get down with them, and to provide encouragement and hope. This is much better than issuing anathemas and drawing doctrinal lines in the sand that provide no practical way forward for so many people. And finally, we can tell that Sarah is a preacher. Sarah is a minister. Her presentation can also be viewed through the lens of Pope Francis, his pastoral emphasis, but maybe more especially the emphasis on spirituality. I think her paper is fundamentally a paper on spirituality. I think Sarah overall suggests that the challenge of faithfulness in Christian marriage has to do with the depth of one's incarnational spirituality, one's relationship with Jesus. It seems to me that Luther was one of the more brilliant examples of a believer who championed the possibility of attaining a deep, personal, and direct relationship with a living God in Jesus Christ. In the Roman Catholic tradition, Ignatius of Loyola also proposed the possibility of a direct relationship with God. It got him into a lot of trouble. 8 times pursued by the Inquisition. The idea that we go to God through the sacraments, through the church, through the saints, and so forth. In contrast, Luther and other reformers insisted, and rightly so, that each and every baptized person is called to a personal and direct relationship to the Lord, and indeed, to be a priest. After all, customs, rituals, canon law, the church, all these wonderful and beautiful mediations that we have in our Catholic and tradition are only instruments. They are not the end of the reign of God or the ends of the reign of God. I think Sarah's presentation is a powerful plea for looking at this business of faithfulness in marriage, not from merely a theological, juridical, or historical point of view, but from a deeply mystagogical and a spiritual one. This means really believing that God seeks to and is working in the minds and the hearts and the consciousnesses of the faithful, and that through discerning love, they can be led in the direction of fidelity, even though the road may become rather twisted. For me, one of the most powerful assertions of her talk was, religion for most people, and I quote, religion for most people in our country starts and ends with ethics, trying to be a good person and doing the right thing. This is no more disaster strategy we could adopt than giving in to that tendency by asserting a sexual ethic divorced from its grounding in the person of Jesus Christ. At most, we could hope to accrue a host of converted legalists. If we are to be faithful to the gospel and to the blessing of family, I know I got to end, I'm going to end, then we have to declare not a better or a different law, but first and foremost, a different and a better gospel, or to really hear the one that Jesus Christ taught. We have to reach past the fear of meeting real persons and of being real persons with the good news of God, who turns with favor. Francis would say mercy, or Carrie would say with that economia, upon real persons in all their failures and their vulnerabilities. I take away from Sarah's presentation the idea that the way forward in the promotion of faithfulness in marriage and family life has everything to do with attaining, for those who pursue the calling to marriage, of a real spiritual life renewed day after day by an encounter with Christ himself, leading to that ecstatic life of relationality and neighborliness. This life makes faithfulness, this economy of the Lamb that we must live in, makes faithfulness in marriage a real possibility, and it is nurtured in the daily habit of prayer that opens us to receiving this wonderful gift and the grace that we have in, with, and through Jesus Christ. That's it.
There are many difficult challenges facing the Christian family at the international, national, local, and parish level. Internationally, Christian families throughout the Middle East, the Far East, and Africa are struggling to survive in the face of violent, radical Islamic extremism that has resulted in a new age of Christian martyrdom that many world leaders are describing as a Christian genocide. Christian families in these regions are faced with the choice of conversion to a radicalized form of Islam, paying a high tax to remain Christian in order to stay in their communities, or leaving their homes and businesses as refugees, while being at risk of being martyred for not denying our Lord God and Savior Jesus Christ. In the European countries most affected by the massive influx of refugees, the challenge of how Christians ought to respond to Muslim refugees in a way that is consistent with the Christian virtues of hospitality and charity is a predominant concern. The Christian families in Greece, despite facing economic depression, massive unemployment, and severe banking restrictions, have demonstrated a spirit of mercy and grace in response to the refugees. Many have suggested that Greece, especially the islands close to Turkey, who have provided humanitarian aid despite their own lack of resources, should be nominated for the Nobel Peace Prize as a result of their people's heroic, unselfish response to the refugee crisis. At the national level in these United States, with the Supreme Court's recent ruling allowing for the legalization of same-sex marriage in all 50 states, the Christian family and local parish community is struggling with the spiritual issues that result from such a monumental, fundamental, and historic change in our society. In contemporary American culture, the Christian family is faced with many uncertainties, not only concerning living up to the high standard of faithfulness to Christ and his gospel, but simply living and surviving. All families, Christian and non-Christian, are challenged with the alarming increase in gun violence and mass murder in our streets, schools, and college campuses, the high rate of unemployment, the high cost of a college education and high student debt, the high cost of health care, and the dissatisfaction on both sides of the political spectrum with the current establishment, and frustration felt due to the ineffectiveness of politicians on both the right and the left. Some speak of building bridges and others of building walls. Some speak of healing in the spirit of love, while others shout words that wound in the spirit of hatred. The political state of our union is uncertain, and the Christian family is hard-pressed to find a worthy candidate to support if their standard is one who exemplifies the fullness of the gospel. Uncertainty among Christians as to the proper response to the legalization of same-sex marriage is a particular pastoral concern with a great challenge to the Christian community. In her paper, Accept Their Crowns in Your Kingdom, Dr. Carrie Frost states, and I quote, as with the sacrament of baptism, there is no certainty that the newly illumined will live a life growing in Christ, and there is no certainty that a particular marriage will grow in Christ. In my 30 years of pastoral care to Orthodox Christian families and as a married priest, father and grandfather, I have observed that there is no certainty that children who have been baptized and raised in the church, who attend Divine Liturgy, Sunday school, youth groups, and Bible study on a regular basis, will grow up to embrace, accept, and live the ideal definition of family from the traditional conservative perspective. I have witnessed this uncertainty unfold in the practical administration of the sacraments of marriage and baptism. When I first began my ministry as a Greek Orthodox priest 30 years ago, a couple was required to be in good spiritual standing with the church, meaning that they must have been married both civilly and ecclesiastically in order to baptize their children, and the same standard was required to serve as a married godparent. A promise to raise the children in the faith was also expected. With recent statistics revealing a dramatic decline in the number of baptisms, these requirements are no longer being strictly enforced. Many parents seeking the grace of baptism for their children are married civilly, but not ecclesiastically, or simply not married at all. The strict canonical rule that an Orthodox Christian must marry an Orthodox Christian, or by dispensation, or oikonomia, a Christian baptized in the name of the Trinity, have not changed. Nevertheless, in the context and culture of a diverse contemporary community, the church has responded by opening the grace of the waters of baptism to all children whose parents seek this sacrament, provided that the godparents are in good standing. As a result, speaking from my own pastoral experience, I have seen parents married outside the church and unwed parents as well truly respond to this open-door policy by remaining faithful to the promise still required of them to raise their child in the faith. Dr. Julie Rubio pointed out in her paper Toward a Merciful and Just Response to Divorce that Pope Francis called for mercy for the divorced and remarried. Orthodox Christianity responds to the fact that divorce is the regretful result of human weakness and frailty. And after a period of repentance and reflection, one may seek remarriage and receive Holy Communion. While divorce and remarriage is certainly a challenge of faithfulness for all Christians, I am in full agreement with Dr. Sarah Wilson's view that it is no secret that marriage at all, much less married for life, is getting harder for Americans. In my parish, the number of divorces has been in decline, yet the number of weddings has also been in decline. Another trend that I have been observing is that the overwhelming majority of young adult couples who seek to be married for the first time in the church already live together. Furthermore, with the increase in life expectancy, many people who have been divorced or widowed and are now senior citizens and active in the worshiping community choose to live together with a new partner rather than to remarry. Indeed, the very definition of the family may be one of the greatest challenges facing Christianity today in the United States. A brief review of the biblical record reveals that the traditional conservative and ideal definition of the Christian family was as one husband, one wife, married for life and raising children in the church, based on the prototype of Adam and Eve, married for life and raising children in the church, stands in contrast to the witness, another witness. The family life is described in the Hebrew scriptures of Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, David, and Solomon tell a story of polygamy, infidelity, and adultery. In spite of this reality, the God of Israel revealed himself to his chosen people through these very patriarchs and kings. Moving forward to the Greek scriptures, in the predominantly patriarchal genealogy of Jesus Christ, only four matriarchs are mentioned. These are Rahab, a prostitute, Ruth, a Moabite, not a Jew, Bathsheba, who was married to Uriah, who David had killed to take her as his wife after they committed adultery, and of course Mary, the mother of Jesus, who was pregnant outside of wedlock, and whose fiancé Joseph was a widower, and who, according to tradition, had children from his first marriage. These couples all fall outside of the one husband, one life, one wife for life ideal, yet God chose them as the ancestors of our Lord Jesus Christ. The very identity of the family is challenged by Christ himself. In the familiar story in the Gospel of Matthew, Jesus, in the midst of his healing and teaching ministry, was told that his mother and his brothers were just outside and wished to speak to him. He answered with the question, "Who is my mother and who are my brothers?" Pointing his hand to his disciples, he said, "Behold my mother and my sisters and my brothers. For whoever does the will of my Father in heaven is my brother and sister and mother." From this teaching, it is possible also to say that the church is a type of family. The church family, seeking to do the will of God, even when her children fall short of her glory, is an extended family in Christ. Is the church family limited to traditional families? Does the couple living together outside of marriage belong to the church family? Does the same-sex couple belong to the church family? Does the divorced and remarried couple belong to the church family? Is the church family inclusive or exclusive of everyone seeking salvation through Christ Jesus? Regarding church discipline required to be a disciple and do the will of God the Father, Scripture and tradition present two parallel paths, one paved on the hard ground of strictness and another paved by the softer soil of mercy, the path of oikonomia, or dispensation. John the Baptist took the hard road, condemning Herod for adultery, and justifiably so. Jesus' hard teaching on divorce and remarriage, with the exception of adultery, continued on the straight way of the forerunner. Jesus sanctified traditional marriage by his presence and miracle at Cana in Galilee. Yet Jesus also displayed deep compassion by protecting the woman from being stoned when she was caught in the very act of adultery. The example of Jesus revealing his divinity to the Samaritan woman at the well, who was married five times and living with a man, gives us a picture of Christ's inclusiveness in ministering to outcasts and sinners, I being the chief among them. In our church community today, how do we remain faithful to the gospel of Christ if we place too much emphasis on our sacramental life, on exclusiveness rather than inclusiveness? I have heard countless times from singles, young and old alike, that the church is so oriented to the traditional conservative view of marriage and the family that they feel there is no place for them in the pew. The Orthodox bishops in America issued a joint statement after the Supreme Court decision on same-sex marriage confirming the traditional definition of matrimony as one male and one female with the potential to raise children, and I am obedient to that teaching. Nevertheless, we are admonished as priests by our bishops, the very same bishops, to minister to those in our congregation who have same-sex attraction with mercy and compassion, and not with exclusion or condemnation. Ought not this same principle of mercy be applied to all those who wish to do the will of God and seek salvation as a disciple of Jesus Christ, yet fall outside of the traditional definition of the ideal family? Our church needs to welcome and minister with greater urgency to singles, divorced, widowed, and to all couples, regardless of their sexual orientation, who are yearning to be part of the Christian family they grew up in and love from the very depths of their souls. In the midst of all the uncertainties mentioned above, one thing I am certain of, that the celebration of same-sex marriage will never be embraced by the Orthodox Christian or Roman Catholic Church. And I agree with that. Nevertheless, we Orthodox and Catholics, while remaining sacramentally faithful to the traditional view of marriage and family, must recognize that it is not only the divorced and remarried who need to be welcomed and embraced with love and compassion, but all those people who walk outside of our accepted ideal of family who truly seek Christ, as Pope Francis said, in our holy Catholic and Apostolic Church, and who wish to be his disciples. To be faithful to the gospel of our Lord God and Savior Jesus Christ and the extended family of his disciples, there needs to be not only a place in the pews for everyone, but in our hearts for all who leave the pew and dare to come forward to the call to Holy Communion, to draw near to Christ and to receive the Holy Eucharist with deep reverence for God, with faith, and with love. Every family and every home experiences conflict and uncertainty. The church is one diverse, extended family. The mothers and fathers and brothers and sisters of Jesus Christ. We are all his disciples if we seek to do the will of God, even when we fall short of the ideal. Like the refugees seeking shelter on the Greek islands, the majority of whom being Muslims, and the Greeks who embrace their arrival with love and mercy, the majority of whom being Christians. May we, the extended family of the church, embrace and welcome all who seek shelter from the stormy seas of life, traditional and non-traditional families, with open arms and open minds and hearts overflowing with love.
I'd like to thank our respondents once again, Father Allen and Father Michael, and perhaps also beg a little bit of mercy from Father Allen. So at this time, I'd like to invite our panelists to return to the front, and we have some time for questions. So as you can see, there are microphones on either side of the auditorium. We'd invite you to come forward. I believe we have about 15 to 20 minutes before lunch. Please, Tom.
I want to thank all the panelists for their fine talks, and Father Curry, especially for the questions you raised. I think those are really essential questions. I wanted to ask a question of Julie Hannon Rubio about this recent synod. You know, my own understanding is that the proposal that was authored and approved that brought the Germans together, Cardinal Mueller and Cardinal Marx, was for the internal internal forum solution, which is not a canonical solution, but a pastoral solution to Catholics and second marriages, which is used throughout the United States, even though Rome doesn't really approve of it. And it's a way of bringing people to make their own decision after prayer and discernment and conversation with a spiritual director or confessor. And then whether or not they feel to come free to communion is really their decision. So I don't think they have to wait for Pope Francis's decision on that, even though it didn't mention communion. Although it's very interesting to see what he's going to say about this really compromised solution. So that's my question. I also want to ask all the panel, and I'm very glad Father Curry raised this issue of the diminishing number of people that seek to be married sacramentally today. That's an enormous problem. I did some research on that recently. The number of annulments in the Catholic Church has fallen from roughly 40,000 to 20,000, which means people aren't bothering anymore. Not that their marriages are working. And the fact that fewer and fewer people are getting married in the Catholic Church, and I suspect that's true of other churches, is something I think the panel needs to address. You know, how do we lift up the institution of marriage today so that it can be seen as the rich sacramental reality that it is? Thank you.
Thanks, Tom. Yes, the German theologians were talking about the internal forum, and that in itself is a compromise solution, but it's one that even though sometimes practice is not, in my understanding, is not completely accepted yet, and was very controversial among the bishops. So my understanding is what we're waiting for from Pope Francis is confirmation that pastorally this is something that can be explicitly offered to those who are divorced and remarried without an annulment. Although he has already put into effect rules to ease annulment, to speed it up, to make it less expensive, and things like that. But as you're saying, the numbers are dropping, and also some studies that I've seen are saying that for many people, those are not actually the main impediments, in that it's not that it's too cumbersome or expensive a process. It's that they don't actually, for many, that it doesn't work. It doesn't help them make sense of their marriage, because perhaps they think that the first marriage was in fact a true marriage, right? So, and the language of indissolubility doesn't work for them. On the second question, which I hope others will respond to too, I do think that's a really fundamental question. On the one hand, it does seem to me that there is, especially in the U.S., still an awful lot of faith in marriage. I mean, just the wedding industry, for all its many, many flaws, still suggests that we care about this. Difficult ways. So I think there's something there to build on, how to transfer that to what we have to offer in the church, I think is a really important pastoral question. We do have to say more about why marriage itself matters, what it brings. And that's where I really do think this telling the stories of marriage is so important. I often say to my students, where are those movies about marriage, right? Marriage relationships over time versus courtship, right? And can we lift up that as something we want people to attain? I think we could do a much better job of that.
Okay. So when I think about this question of how we can lift up marriage to be seen, for me, I think there's even a deeper pastoral issue, and that is what we as Christians have to offer to contemporary secular society that contemporary secular society does not have and will never have. And this was actually a theme I saw in our talks, which is an understanding of human personhood, an understanding of the uniqueness, the irreplaceability, the knownness, the flawed but always loved quality of what it means to be a human person. And that's the basis for our understanding of marriage. That's the basis for how we treat anyone who walks into the church doors, as Father Michael pointed out. And for me, that's what we need to articulate and present to the world.
My co-panelists have already given you wise words, so I'll just add one brief remark. I think one reason why people don't want to get married is because they don't want to get divorced. And I think the number of people today who are of age to get married have come out of divorce relationships and seen how terrible that is. And I think there's this gut level reaction, if I don't ever get married, I won't ever get divorced. At the same time, most young people, and the older you get, the more it's the case, have been through multiple divorces of their own. Even though they never got married, the relationships that they've had that were serious, intimate, and broke up, they've been through divorces so many times already. So in some ways, there's kind of a question of what actually is marriage and what would make this risk worthwhile after the sustained damage. And there, I think we definitely need the help of people who would work in youth ministry to talk about how in a helpful and not in a shaming kind of way, help young people do the hard task of managing their relationships or sexuality in a way that will have lifelong benefit instead of multiple cases of devastation.
My name is Lila. I'm a pro-life activist and prayer warrior and sidewalk counselor in front of abortion clinics to let you know what the background of this is. I've also I'm a Latin Rite Catholic. I've recently started attending the Greek Catholic liturgy. And to let you know that too, where I'm coming from. I already complimented Pastor Wilson on mentioning abortion during her talk and also mentioning just now in her answer what I have discovered in doing pregnancy counseling. People don't want to get married because they don't want to get divorced. They are literally afraid of marriage, and I compliment you for that wisdom. And I have a question of Dr. Frost. I notice it says in the booklet, it wasn't raised during the talk, but Dr. Frost has done a dissertation on the theology of motherhood and also a study of the Mother of God in icons, which I'm interested in as a new, congregation member of a Greek Catholic church, and also the pastoral care of perinatal and infant loss. And my basic question is, how can I get a copy of these things, if possible? And
I have a really quick answer, which is that we can talk afterwards, and I'll give you my contact information.
I welcome anybody to comment on what I just said.
So those issues are near and dear to my heart, and particularly the issue of miscarriage and stillbirth and infant death, and those are places where the Orthodox Church has excelled and comforted in some ways, but also not always lived up to its ideals. And so the context for that is I've been working with a group on creating a pastoral guide for priests. So when they experience this sort of loss in their parish, they have some idea of what to do and how to handle it. And I'm also working with a group that seeks to change our rites. We have rites in our church, prayers that are said after a miscarriage, to make those more humane and compassionate. And the Orthodox Church in America has approved, in fact, a new version of that, which is a mercy and a blessing.
Hi, my name's Indira. Oh man, I don't even know where to start. Well, I do agree with the panelists, and thank you for coming, about how to lift marriage, being an example, and giving hope. And I was a single mom for like 7 years. I was married through the church, divorced, and just recently, last month, I got an annulment from the church, thanks to Pope Francis and for the reform and the process that he changed. And I never gave up. I wasn't obviously the perfect marriage, but I never gave up, and the church brought hope to me and my son again. And Jesus gave everybody a second chance when he was here. We were all sinners, and he forgave them and forgave me. And I think he will not close the doors to anybody but open the window of hope, and that's what Pope Francis brought to my life. And I know the Orthodox Church believes that people are weak that divorce. I don't feel like that I was weak. If anything, I feel that I was strong because I was in a marriage that was trying to destroy me mentally, emotionally, and spiritually. And God gave me the strength and opened the window and said, get out, there's a second chance. there's a second chance to marriage. There's a second chance to have another child. And I also believe in the Bible where it says, on Matthew 18:18, truly I say to you, whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. So I'm really thankful for the reform with Pope Francis, and I'm just really thankful that I came to hear your different beliefs of your different religions, and that's about it. Yeah, that's it.
Thanks so much for that. I think it's really important that we do remember in all the talk about weakness and sin and divorce that in some cases it is with strength, right? And recognition of human dignity that people are able to walk away. And that's something that, although we acknowledge especially the reality of difficult marriages, of abusive marriages, we don't say near enough, and that reality that Father Allen is calling us to recognize is somehow absent from our more theoretical conversations about divorce, and that's so important to bring that back.
I agree, and you know, I think that I don't think I used the word weakness, and I don't think that is a word that I would use. And when I spoke to children in a marriage and the concern for children, that same idea applies to the adults in a marriage too, is that marriage should not be an idol on which people's health and safety is sacrificed. And I think that plays out in the way divorce is handled and remarriage is handled in the Orthodox Church.
There, please.
Hi, my name is Victor Vallejo, and I have a question for all three panelists. Before people get married, there is a stage of dating and courtship. How do each of the three traditions address this? Because this is so critical in picking out your life partner.
If Luther gave dating advice, I'm not aware of it. and as you know, he was talked into it in the end by the one last nun who refused to settle for anyone less. And he openly acknowledged they grew to love each other after the marriage, not before. I personally consider it a mark of progress that the Christian tradition has continually insisted on love and consent as being crucial to a relationship. If you look at a world historical view of human sexuality, love and consent, especially on the woman's part, have never been major considerations. Economic considerations, dowries, political alliances, getting heirs, whatever, those have been a lot more dominant. So I'm glad for that. And I think we should definitely invest in this progress we've made to help people make good choices that are based on love and consent in a marriage. But I don't really see, at least, I don't know. I know there are programs out there to try to help people at least delay sexual intimacy. But in terms of actually like finding and evaluating a marital partner, it seemed to be kind of on your own. And then when you've made up your mind, you come to the church. And maybe if you have good premarital counseling, a pastor or a priest can help you identify that this is not going to work out. But that's already at a point where some level of commitment has already taken place. I don't know for myself how the church would get involved in a way that wouldn't be kind of creepy. But there has to be, I think Julie alluded to this more, is that if the witness and stories of marriage are more a part of church and communal life, then people will kind of have the option, young people who want to get married will have a chance of evaluating that. And if there are people they trust, if they're, you know, blinded by infatuation to what's not going to be a good thing, hopefully those people they trust can help them kind of step back on the situation.
Just add two things. One is that I think what one thing that makes the dating and courtship period difficult and the choice of a marriage partner is this very pervasive myth of the one. It just some 95% of young adults think that they're supposed to marry the one, this mystical person who's out there. And I just find that to be, it's a very difficult belief because it sets us up to think, to look for these qualities, this almost mystical connection, and then when married and when things aren't going so well, to think I haven't found the one, I need to find another one. And so I like to talk about figuring out how to be the one for the other person, and that's a task, not a mystical connection. So the romantic view needs to be dislodged in some ways. We can't throw it out completely, but it has to be taken up into a personalist theology of marriage that has room for the crown, the cross, right, as well. I have some theologian friends who write about dating, a theology of dating. Jason King is one, and that seems to me to be a helpful place to think about dating as a practice, especially to be approached from a place of faith, which would involve other kinds of practices. What should we do together when we date? What would that look like if we're actually looking to marry? How would those practices form us? I think those are useful conversations. And also, finally, we need to remember that in the U.S., we're dealing with at least two marriage cultures, a serious economic and educational divide. And things look very different for people who are college level and those who are not going to college. And so it's important that when we think about new church practices, we think about those very different realities. And for those with less privilege, often they have the same idea. We need to wait to be set and also to find the one, but they're more worried about what they see around them because there is more divorce in those communities, and also they're less likely to be set economically, and so then they're waiting to marry. So different approaches are needed depending on the pastoral context.
So within Orthodoxy, I like what both of you have said and appreciated for sure in the Orthodox context. But within Orthodoxy, you know, it's my opinion that we have had cultural traditions of courtship and dating, but especially in the situation of the United States, those have fallen away, maybe for good or for bad. The one small thing I see happening in the Orthodox world is there's a few places where couples are now being publicly betrothed. And that is like an engagement, and that is actually the first part of what is now put together as the marriage rite, as a betrothal service. And the idea there is that the courtship and the commitment to each other is happening in community, rather than this very isolated, the one and like the proposal and the ring and the flowers strewn on the floor or whatever. But this is happening with your family and with your parish community around you, and I think there's something healthy and really interesting about that.
Very quickly, last question.
God. Okay. I would like to thank you for having this. I'm very blessed that the panelists are female. I was very blessed by that. It's very timely as well to have this sort of forum with recent attacks on the traditional view of family life and marriage, whether within each of the traditions that are represented, whether it be adultery, pedophilia, transgender issues that have come about, abortion, the use of contraception, the octomom, that whole thing. I would love to see more of this, but my question is, I guess for each of the panelists, from each perspective, where do we begin to address these issues within the church and outside of the church, whether it's on a local or does it need to come from the top jurisdictionally from each bishop or cardinal? How do we start and kind of meet each of these needs with the economia we were talking about, the pastoral care, the relationship that was brought up?
I think for me, the best thing we can do is talk openly about sexual abuse and assaults. I have to say this did not come on my radar screen until later in life because I thank God I've never been the victim of it, though I have been sexually harassed. I think most women probably have. But there were a lot of things going on among my peers that were not comprehensible to me, and it was only when I sort of accidentally made myself a safe person to talk to about sexual assault because I like heard statistics and didn't blame the victim, and suddenly friends started saying, well, you know, this happened to me. And a lot of things about a lot of sexual dysfunction came into focus for me there. And then I found this is not something we talk about publicly. It's beginning to happen in our wider culture, and I'm glad of that, but I think the church is still really frightened of talking about it. And I think we need to make it okay for victims to come forward and not be shamed. And I think we need to identify who are the perpetrators in our communities and what got them there. They're often victims of abuse themselves. But I personally think that a lot of the dysfunction we see stems out of this assault on what it means to be a human being, sexually speaking. And everything is going to be kind of band-aid solutions until we get at this violence at the heart of who we are.
I've also found, so I don't know if I have a solution for the whole church, what you're asking for, but I have found in my own teaching of undergraduates that it also is that encounter with the violence that sex can do that helps them be able to reflect upon sex and relationships and persons at a deeper level. So once we can identify something that we seriously understand to be wrong, which is a helpful starting point in ethics, then we can build from there and ask other questions about what would be good, what would be right. And knowing how powerful sex is helpful. It can be powerfully damaging, and then also then we begin to think about how powerfully healing and elevating it can be. But I would also say that it's important that as much as we might recognize attacks, that we also recognize that most people have longings. And those longings are what we need to connect to, right? So if we're always criticizing the culture and talking about how different they are from us, that can be difficult for people to enter into. But if we can show them that we can talk more about how their deepest longings can actually be fulfilled in what we offer, I think that's a much better starting place.
I also don't have an answer for the entire church. but just to speak to the way I personally feel called to address some of these things, that is through the ritual action of our church. You know, as Orthodox Christians, we understand the world through our worship. That's how we grieve. That's how we garner hope. That's how we process. And so I mentioned my work earlier on the miscarriage rites. I also work on what are called the churching rites, and this is getting a little bit into like Orthodox esoterica. But there's a rite where women are welcomed back to church after childbearing. And there's some unfortunate language in that connects childbearing with ideas of impurity. And that's not a Christian understanding of what it means to procreate and bring life into this world. So that's a place where I work, is making sure that our rites authentically reflect our Christian love and embrace for humans, even babies and new mothers.
I want to once again thank our three panelists for their words of wisdom.